what needs to be done now. Obviously, agriculture, in particular market access and domestic support, and NAMA, industrial tariffs, remain the flagships of the convoy. But, I repeat, I think everybody is aware that the convoy is larger and that the whole of the fleet needs to arrive together. We also have services where the Hong Kong Declaration was reasonably prescriptive and opened the door for plurilateral negotiations which will now start and which obviously are very much demand-driven, and I think for the negotiations to achieve some progress in the coming weeks, we need obviously the request offer process to be seriously intensified. And of course, rules, TRIPS, environment, trade facilitation, DSU, although not part of the single undertaking, S&D implementation, and the rest. In order to make sure that all ships navigate in the convoy, we've looked at the paper we discussed in Davos, which sets out the various timelines of our work this year. This is not an agreed document. This is a tool to assist all of us in keeping an overview of the progress that is needed to advance the negotiation as a whole, and in making sure that no issue slips behind. And as you very well know, the members of the organization have various horses running in various races, and they want to make sure that no horse and no race is forgotten. How will this progress now happen? I think it's through a mix of Geneva-based working in the negotiating groups, and you are aware that since a fortnight negotiating groups are back to work, and I think with a resolve of increasing activity, which is welcome. Of course, also a series of bilateral discussions and consultations among members, not least to test numbers in agriculture, domestic support, in agriculture, market access, and industrial tariffs. This testing period has obviously started, and I believe it is useful, although it is only preliminary to an agreement, which would be, of course, multilateral, on the parameters of the formulas, and I think there is no doubt, if there was any doubt at some stage, that the formula approach will remain as agreed in 2004. This, of course, will be complemented by a series of ministerial contacts in various locations and in various geometries, so that we make sure that the negotiation remains on the center of the radar screen of trade ministers and, in some cases, governments as a whole. So to conclude this brief introduction, after the Hong Kong sort of touchdown, we now need to gain altitude and cruising speed. I think the good news is that we have a reasonably clear flight plan that will help us all doing this. I think this plane is now cruising again, and I'll close now, and the next report to Tower I will be doing is next month in the TNC. Deadlines in themselves are not the essential. I mean, what is the essential is narrowing differences on numbers and on texts, which is what the negotiation is about now. I'm following very closely what's happening again in various contacts, and for the moment I've no indication that narrowing these differences to the point of agreeing to modalities would not be possible by the end of April.
Yes, can you tell us which ministers you will be meeting in South Africa and which issues you plan to take up with them?
Well, the South African visit is first visit with South Africa, and here I will have a series of contacts, as I have in each and every country I visit, with the President, with the Trade Minister, with the Finance Minister, with the former Trade Minister, who now has another position in the government but who kept interested in trade issues, and with a number of academics and civil society, and notably this club, NEDLAC, which South Africa has, which is a multi-partite organization between notably civil society, employers and trade unions, who follows very thoroughly trade issues in this country. This will be followed by an informal gathering of various ministers, of heads of states and government, which will take place, if I understand well, the next day. This is informal, and I will be answering questions on WTO-related trade issues, although it's only part of the agenda of this informal gathering, with all those who will be there by under the invitation of the President of South Africa.
Mr. Lamy, Daniel Prusen with the Bureau of National Affairs. You talked about a testing period which is now underway, where people are exchanging ideas on numbers, figures. Could you give us an idea of what four of these discussions are taking place and how they will eventually be incorporated into the WTO process?
As you know, take the example of industrial tariffs, which is in many ways the simple one as compared to agricultural market access or to agricultural domestic support. There are a few numbers which need to be agreed in order to reach the modality stage. And they need to be tested, because I don't think members, and notably the sort of core negotiators about industrial tariffs, which obviously are sort of EU, US, Japan and G20 countries, can agree on a set of numbers without getting a clear sense of what the result of this is for people who do not care a lot about parameters, numbers, coefficients, flexibilities, Article 8 or 6 or 5 or 4, who want to understand what's the result of this in tons of or billions of. And the translation of these complex parameters, which we have to agree on formula, into tons of or billions of, needs a series of tests, a series of simulation, and a series of decisions by, notably, for instance, developing countries who know that they will have to reduce their tariffs, but who have to choose what flexibilities they will use. And in order to make this choice, they need to consult with other members, not least to get a sense of whether protecting some tariff lines from the cuts which will result from the formula fits or not with the overall agreement of their trade partners. We've been negotiating this for a long time. We've made progress in the negotiation, because I think now the result is reasonably framed in the heads of the participants, who are starting to focus on the final picture, and we have this sort of sequencing with this April deadline which I hope helps people not only narrowing their options, and this is what I just described in terms of looking at simulations and bilateral contacts, but also, I mean, identifying the final round of the final tarmac. And I think this is starting to appear in the minds of a number of ministers, and the good news, I think, is that it is not to the detriment of the level of ambition. But we all know that at the end of the day, that's going to be the crucial issue, whether we reach the level of ambition which is required. And my sense is that, and I already said that publicly, it's not like a sort of an auction sale where prices go down until the negotiation is finished. I think there is a level, a threshold in the level of ambition, which is under which there will be no agreement. So it is not a negotiation which time will conclude to the price of the level of ambition. It is a banded approach, like in the Hague formula. There is a band within which results will be attainable, but below a certain level of ambition, I don't think any prospect for any results is there.